followed up by life, and that more abundantly, a city of pure, unabounded joy. There is a land of unclouded day where storm clouds never rise. In that happy land, there is no bread line or struggle for survival. There is no selfish competition. There is no self-seeking to engender unloving suspicion. No one is anxious as to what he shall eat or what he shall wear. The garments of white will never grow threadbare. The trees with the fruits of life will never be barren. The water of life will never run dry, and whosoever will may drink. All the joy and enthusiasm of the most joyful youth is the inheritance of everybody in heaven. But in our most happy days we are still in a vessel of clay. In our highest moments we sense a still greater joy and a happiness almost within the reach of our hands. But ere it can be taken, we are dragged away by the weight of the clay. Children frolic and play. They run and roll, and they leap for joy. They sing and they shout. At times their joy and happiness seem complete. Of such is the kingdom of heaven. But the highest exuberant joys and the most ecstatic thrills of bliss of the happiest youth on earth are to be superseded by the greater joy that is unspeakable when this body of hindering clay has been replaced by the body that is real. In the New Jerusalem, everybody is in love. Everybody is in love with everybody else. Being in love on earth is as nothing compared with being in love in the land of glory. Not a flaw, not an imperfection, not an unlovely trait will detract from being perfectly and altogether in love with everybody. On earth, in our encumbrance of this depraved tabernacle, there is a song in the soul. In its struggle for expression, there are times it seems to break out of its restraint for a second. But as quickly, the perfect chord is lost. When God made man, he put music in his soul. But the discords of the mud have spoiled the harmony. The lost chord will never be found until it is found in heaven, when we are clothed upon with the tabernacle that is from above. The finest, the sweetest, the most perfect music on earth is but a seeking for the lost chords and harmonies the redeemed and the angels sing in heaven. The finest instruments of music that have been made on earth, from the days when the sons of Adam began to handle the harp and pipe, until the present day, are as mere imitations of the trumpets, the harps, and the instruments upon which the lost chords are restored in the golden city, and upon which all the music of the liberated soul can find its fullest expression. Much of the music and the rhythm the Father placed in the souls of his children has since been turned by the devil into evil channels for pleasures of the lust of the perverted flesh. From the wildest barbarians in the mountain fastness to the pleasure-intoxicated wild men of the fashionable ball, men dance in musical rhythm to find sensual pleasure that is of the lust of the flesh. In heaven, to the tune of music that is holy and pure, the redeemed and the angels dance in joy that is beyond all earthly or natural pleasure in the rhythm to which the stars are swinging and singing in their orbits. There is a park in the city, an Eden park of pleasure and fruits. Here, where the unreal has been replaced by the real, in all God's animal and plant creation, there is nothing that hurts or destroys in all the holy mount. On earth we see little and understand less of the beauties of God's creation. The dirt and the dust of the earth have clouded the windows of our soul. We scarcely see through the glass, even darkly. When God has brushed away the encumbrances and opened the eyes of the soul, for the first time will we really look upon and appreciate the glories of God's wonderful creation. All this will we do in the Eden over there. There is a park where the birds of all plumes are ever singing. There is a land where every ear will be tuned to hear their soul-stirring anthems. There is a land where flowers of every hue are ever blooming. There is a land where every eye will be opened to see them in their beauty. There is a land where the fragrance of the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valley mingle with a thousand perfumes that over our world have never blown. Sometimes we seem to see the light of the city beyond the sky, but our vision is lost in the blur of imperfect sight. Sometimes we seem to hear the enchanting music of a different sphere, but the strain is lost in the discord of sounds that are nearer. Sometimes we seem to sense an upward pull away from all that is enslaving, but the attraction of earth holds our feet like stocks in the fetters that are earthly. Sometimes the soul would fly to the land that is fairer than day, but it falls back in disappointment because of its broken wings. He who declares his freedom to walk alone to the city of freedom finds his pathway hopelessly blocked by the things of this world, the flesh, and the devil, with no power in himself to overcome. But there is a way. Chapter 12. The Way. There is only one way. Christ is the way. No one cometh unto the Father but by me. Man is not the way. Man can never make a way. Nor does man ever know the way to the golden city. The city and the way to the city are altogether revelations from above. Christ, who is the way, is not from below. He is from above. It is he that descended out of heaven, even the Son of Man who is in heaven, who is the great God, our Savior Jesus Christ. Man does not travel toward the happy city of pure delight. He travels away from it. The longer he walks, the farther he gets away from this heavenly city. Children belong to the kingdom of God. They play and frolic at the gates of the city. When they begin to walk alone, they always walk away from the city, away from this happy Eden home. The farther they wander and the more they reason, whether they walk alone or follow the crowd, the farther they get from the city, until its light is but dimly seen or lost forever. The only way to reach the city is to turn back. Except ye turn and become as little children, ye shall in no wise enter the kingdom of heaven. But the farther man walks alone, the older he gets, the richer he becomes, the more he studies with his natural mind, the more he passes turnstiles in his self-conceited course, until, at last, the farther turnstiles refuse to move, that should turn him back to a simple faith. He finds no way of returning to a heart like a little child. The world, through its wisdom, knew not God. Man, by study, will never find God. The man who trusts the workings of his own mind or the minds of other men will never see the city of God. Man, on the merits of his character, will never walk the golden streets. What a man is, what a man does, or how a man lives has nothing to do with his salvation. On the basis of how good he is, the best man on earth has no more hope of heaven than the worst man on earth. Man who trusts in his own character, his own moral goodness, is only a modern Pharisee with eyes blinded to the truth. The publican, the drunkard, the harlot will enter the city of God, while that good man will be cast into outer darkness where is weeping and gnashing of teeth. By grace we are saved, apart from works. Salvation is something God gives. It is not something man is or is not. Salvation is from above. It is not from below, or from within, or from among men. That which is born from below is flesh, and born by the will of man. Those born from below, no matter how wise or good or bad they may become, must be born again from above. They become the children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Except one be born anew, he cannot see the kingdom of God. This birth that every accountable man must have, who will ever see God or sing the songs of the redeemed in the city beyond the sky, is a supernatural birth. It is altogether from above. Joining church, singing hymns, reading or saying prayers, working in or for the church, preaching from the pulpit, or giving all one's body to be burned, has nothing whatever to do with the new birth. The new birth is something that God gives by grace, regardless of works. The finest pulpit orator, the most formal churchman, the most protesting Protestant, has no more hope of heaven than the most reckless sinner, unless he be born again. How to find the way back home. The Lord was so anxious to have me return that he made the way simple and plain. I was a sinner living selfishly and not alone for the glory of God. I had returned to my own way. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. They have all turned aside. I was among the number. Jesus came from heaven to save sinners, not righteous people with good characters. Thus I had my chance. I should have suffered the penalty of my sin, but Christ loved me and died in my stead. He bore my sins in his body upon the tree. Christ died on the cross, the sinless one, instead of the sinner. He who knew no sin died in my place on the cross where I should have died. I, the sinning Barabbas, the punishment-deserving sinner, was set absolutely and unconditionally free. He who knew no sin was made sin in our behalf. God punished Jesus, so he will not punish me. Because he forsook Jesus, he will not forsake me. All I had to be was to be a sinner. All I had to do was to do nothing. I simply believed that Jesus did it all. He that believeth hath eternal life. He that believeth hath passed out of death into life. To them that believe, he gives the right to become sons of God. Having believed that Jesus did what he said he